I have the pleasure to take you to a travel to my most beloved city in the world, which you will see right now. It's Damascus, one of the oldest continuously inhabited cities in the world, more than 6,000 years old. But from the private residences, there are only houses preserved from at least 5 centuries or so. But I will take you to the youngest past. It's mainly the 18th and 19th century. My starting point, of course, is these two Syrian interiors that are preserved in Shangri-La. I just put these images to remind you how they look like. And I will get you to the journey now to Damascus. This is how Damascus looked like for millenniums, I think, because the city is situated in an oasis and had more or less this size and appearance since antique times. But today we cannot experience it like this anymore because it changed a lot since the middle of the 20th century, just grown up to 3.5 million inhabitants from 500,000 70 years ago. So, I mean, it's a big increase and, yeah, containing all the problems of these expanding cities too. But fortunately, still in this orange circle, the old city is preserved, with about 3,000 to 4,000 historic private homes. And these photos illustrate how you should imagine Damascus in the 19th century and even in the late 18th, because it didn't change much. After the earthquakes in 1795, the city has been rebuilt, and this is preserved by these photographs. The city is built by a structure like little boxes. The houses were put together like that. When another room in the house was necessary, they just built up a new cube, and that's why the structure looked like if bees built up their houses. It's quite different than to the urban structures that we are familiar with. I just want to introduce some terms that will appear during my talk repeatedly. If you see in the captions the word bet or dar, it just means house. Juwani and Barani, they describe the inner and outer courtyards, an important feature of Damascene houses. An iwan is this open space, which you see already in the photograph. The kaa will appear very often because this is a term for the reception rooms and the most precious halls in Syrian houses. And these rooms, they are divided into spaces, in lower entry space that is called ataba, and in taza, which is always a raised seating area. You will see a lot of that during the talk, but I just wanted to introduce some Arabic. Damascus looks for centuries more or less like this if you walk through the streets. Completely plain and not spectacular at all. The walls are just plastered by mud coatings and partly by some lime wash, but that's it. No adornment, no precious things from the outside. And also the entrance doors to the private homes are not very much adorned. Most of them, they are this size, quite small, that you are able to enter without bowing your head, but not something very welcoming, I would say. And the large palaces, they have larger doors with a small separate door to slip in for normal visitors. And often, if you enter these houses, you come through a dark, narrow corridor, and leaving just the dust and noise from the street behind you, and then suddenly you enter a typical Damascene courtyard, because these houses are arranged around an open courtyard, which always has a pleasant fountain in the center. And in the south wing of the house, there is this open hall. It's always shaded from the sun, and this is the main living space for the family for most of the year. I was happy or lucky to find at least one historic photograph showing local people using the Iwan as a sitting space. The rooms of the house are located surrounding the courtyard, just behind this type of facade. And I would just invite you to follow me into these rooms. It could be a door like this, which leads to one of the oldest preserved interiors in Damascus, or it could be a door like this. And if you enter this room, you face a typical architectural feature that is a niche called Masab in Arabic. And this is the place where this water ewer is placed, just to wash the hands even before praying. If you raise your head, you will see a wooden ceiling, which is mostly a beam ceiling, like this example. And turning to the left, you will see another type of ceiling, which evokes a carpet. And looking down, you see this seating area of a typical reception room for guests, equipped with a low divan and a carpet and a small table. And these images illustrate historic interiors. And it's really rare to find one like on the right side that shows still the historic furnishing of such a room. All these equipments were placed to allow a comfortable seating and spending time in these houses for the reception of guests. And these living spaces are not equipped with heavy furniture like we are used to it, like beds or tables or other heavy cupboards, for example. All the belongings are stored inside these wall cupboards, and shelf niches are used to display precious items, and the central niche is even used to place the bedding stuff during the day, which will be just unfolded at night. I just want to show you some more examples of these common features, these different types of cupboards and another type of masab. And these images illustrate pretty nice how these shelf niches were used, because they have their name from their use as storage for books. That's why they are called kitbir. But in many families, they were also used to display the luxurious items of the family. It was something like the business card of a traditional Damascene family, just displaying also porcelain. This is a view to a main wall, or to typical examples of main walls of these rooms. And what struck me a lot was long time that they are empty. And if you imagine these rooms being nicely equipped with rich carpets and silk embroidery on cushions and something like that, I couldn't believe that this main space should be empty. And then I get the assumption that is the place for the bedding. And it means it might have been coated by real fabric just to protect the bedding from dust. And interestingly, all these niches, they have kind of like a ceiling which is painted with a specific type of textile pattern. And then I found out this these fabrics are made in India and Persia, and it's a type of cotton print. So it means these type of cotton prints were luxurious items in Damascus in the 18th century. And then luckily last year I found a proof for my assumption, even this historic photograph showing this type of fabric. And interestingly, the same type of pattern is painted in the Dresden-Damascus room inside a cupboard, really meaning that this was something what was in fashion. Today, if you visit these houses, you will mostly not find these open niches because they are changed to glass cabinets and to normal wall closets, just because the families wanted to use them in a different way. The rooms are equipped with these high wooden ceilings, and even this is related to the function of the room, because in this hot desert climate, the rooms need to be quite high just to retain enough cool air for most of the time of the day. The spaces can even reach such enormous dimensions. It's about 10 meters high and one of the largest reception halls that are preserved in Damascus. Another functional element are, of course, doors and windows. And there we recognize two types. There's one type of window that is placed in the upper wall zone, made from gypsum and glass. It's cut into a plate of gypsum, and then the glass pieces were fixed to it. And these windows are simply made to provide the room with light. And they can even be arranged in two rows in these very high entry spaces. The windows appear in two types. One with these very fine ornaments. And these type of windows even appear here in Shangri-La because George Duke purchased a lot of this type. And the other more simple version is on the left, just with geometric simple shapes. The windows in the lower part of the walls are just equipped with a metal grille and actually without any window glass, because they were just provided, used to provide the room with air. Because in this hot desert climate, the air condition was quite necessary during the hours around noon. And if it's too hot, then the rooms were closed with the window shutters and then just reopened after 2-3 hours. And if they are closed, then they become an element of the interior decoration. And with the doors, it's the opposite. They become an element of the outer facade. And interestingly, the spaces when the doors open inside the room are always prepared to enable the fitting of the door to these recesses. Here are some more examples of these precious doors, and they even show kind of a fashion development through 80 years. As you maybe have already sensed, these rooms are equipped with a lot of different materials and decorations, and I would like to introduce some of these precious surfaces. First, I would let you see some floor pavement. This is the most durable material in these rooms and courtyards, used for floor pavement, but also for these bed borders and for fountains. And they also connect the courtyard space with the interior space of the living rooms. Nothing is really undecorated in these houses, as these images might illustrate. You find always pattern everywhere. So the floors in these entry spaces are decorated with these stone mosaics, and even interior parts of these wall niches, these masab. Technically, they are made in two different manners. In this type, they are put as small marble pieces together and just let into a mortar bed. And here you see on the right corner another technique. There the pattern is cut into a marble plate and then filled with these small stone pieces and even with mother of pearl. This may illustrate how rich and varying the decoration of this single element is. The mother of pearl inlays appear since mid of the 18th century in Damascus and really grow to a big fashion. Like this example may illustrate, and it's even combined with gilding and other polychrome gilding on the stones. It's an example of a fountain, and if you go back later to the Syrian room, you will see exactly the same pattern on the fountain. Another feature of decoration of Damascene houses is these horizontal stone bending. I think everybody who's familiar with Damascene architecture knows such type of facade. And it looks like stones, but to a closer observer, it becomes evident that it's not stones. It's instead stones that are covered with a thin plaster layer. I was surprised as I found out about this particular technique, because it seems at first more time-consuming. But then after understanding that with handicrafts techniques in the 18th century, it was much more difficult to get a plain, even surface on stone than covering it with plaster. And it's indeed the fact that this plaster that covers the front side also continues to the back sides, like 3-4 centimeter. And so the old craftsman had just to make one side of the stone even and cover it with a plaster and then just simply put it in the walls. And even looking at this, I'm sorry, I'm a conservator, bothering you with details. it shows that the join is very fine in between the stones. And even the surface was roughened to allow a better adhesion of the plaster, because in this hot desert climate, it should be something very stable. Summarizing that, the architectural facades of the houses, and I assume also of the public buildings, were supposed to be like on the right side, with very much homogeneous stripes. It means one has to imagine the rooms like that. Or like that example. And this even shows how the plaster layers were flaking by the humidity from the ground floor. It's another example of the same house. And in some very rare cases, still the entire facade is completely covered with this type of thin plaster. And interestingly, if one looks at historic photographs or even paintings from the 19th century, also the outer facades of public buildings like baths or religious schools are or seem to be covered by such a plaster. But all this is completely forgotten today in Damascus. The surfaces have been cleaned and nothing left almost of that. But it's still evident, like in these historic photographs. Now I'd like to introduce another decoration feature, which is related to the last one. It's called ablak. It's the same name. And it means that the pattern is cut into a stone as it appears on this image. But even here, we see already a damaged surface, because originally we have the same technique like with the plain stone that was first covered with a thin plaster, and then the pattern are cut through this plaster to the stone. And if you grind it today, like the common thing happens in renovation of the houses, you just remove the plaster and the inlays simply are left. So one has to imagine also this type of decoration like it appears in these images, very homogeneous, and the plain stone is never visible. Also the borders of this decoration type is covered with an orange plaster, because I was told in Damascus by a colleague that Islamic art is a culture of lines, and this really makes sense even looking at these images, because you will find everywhere these lines dividing and surrounding everything. Even here it's an example of a well-preserved surface. In the late 18th century, these plain ablak facades were decorated with another type of stone, because it's stone reliefs. I mean, it was mixed, mixed into the former carpet of design, and it's made like this, that you have a soft relief of limestone, and even this is painted with background colors to get a three-dimensional effect. And it appears in enormous varieties in these houses. But most of the surfaces are cleaned off so that you will never be able to see this type of decoration. Like this example demonstrates, most of the houses in Damascus and in collections abroad, or the pieces from the historic houses in collections abroad, appear today with clean stone surfaces, which has nothing in common with the originally intended idea. And last year, I was really happy to discover a well-preserved original piece here in Shangri-La, because most of the stones that are set into the walls here are this cleaned type, but this is perfectly preserved, and I'm very happy with my conservator's eyes. This type of polychromy, it's also used on different stones, not only on limestone, like on the left, also on marble. This even is an example from one of the most precious houses in Damascus. I mean, it's really, I would say, high society decoration. This is the same house, and luckily these pieces, they are part of a huge arch. And in the height of 8 meters, nobody reached them to clean them, because the lower parts are just plain and empty today. But here you still see the originally intended idea of using stone simply as a material to give a three-dimensional shape and not as a plain thing. Same examples here. But I visited about 200 houses during the last 15 years, but I just found 2, 3, 4 houses which still show original surfaces. It's really a treasure. And it's not only decorative art made in this type of decoration, it's also inscriptions that are gilded and painted. And back to the decorative art, this is an example of mid-19th century house, where we see a type of gilding which appears to be shiny in contrast to the dull surfaces of the marble. And this is what I admire so much in these houses, that these this subtle play with light, it's just very much impressive. And if you step back a bit from these pieces, you will get an impression like a veil of pattern hanging on the walls. And they even have such a kind of airy appearance. It doesn't really look like heavy stone. I want to introduce a really pretty rare feature. It is tiles, which are common from Damascene buildings, from mosques and baths, public baths. But today, in private residences, there's almost nothing preserved. But we find them in historic photographs, and here in one example in Hammer. And I found something else interesting, that they also painted tiles to have a decoration appearing like tiles. And this is a fascinating example from the Azen Palace in Hammer, because this type of pattern, it's Dutch tiles, it's Delft tiles that are the prototype for this decoration. And it was fascinating to see that this type of tiles was like a luxurious item in the 18th century, because it's used in the imperial hall of the Topkapi Palace in Istanbul, for example, and in Sultan's baths in Cairo. So if the governor of Hama, another important city in Syria, use tiles to paint them on the walls, it means he want to show very precious and luxurious decoration. And now I will come to my main research topic of the last 15 years. It's these polychrome wooden elements that make up many parts of these interiors. Most of the wooden elements are wall panelings and ceilings. And most of the interiors still in Syria, but also in collections abroad, appear like that. They show a brown surface, also like the ceiling here in the Syrian room. But for a conservator, they reveal some secrets, because the dark surface is just caused by later applied varnishes. And because of their nature as natural resins, they darkened and turn out that brown. But originally, these houses or these interiors have never been coated by any protection layer or something. This is just a later addition. And when removing these darkened varnishes, the historic surfaces can be brought back again. Just showing some of these examples of varnish removal tests. All these are projects that were planned to continue for the entire room, but stopped for the moment because of the political situation. These are even tiny pieces showing the original, very brilliant color scheme. This is a board which has been reused, just flipped over and reused as a cover board for a new ceiling. And because it was never exposed long time to light, it still holds his original very bright pink, which seems unbelievable if looking to the brown rooms today. This is just an insight in one of the conservation projects in Syria. If you remove the varnish, the original very light and friendly colors come back. And then such a ceiling suddenly appears like that. And just to prove that I'm not only a strange conservator destroying antique surfaces, I would just show you some original examples that never have been coated by any later varnish. And surprisingly, they are very bright and friendly and light. And this even reminds people of Indian dresses or Indian textiles. So I hope you will forget brown interiors after this talk. This is one of my, oh, it's not one. This is my favorite interior in Damascus. I discovered it by coincidence in 2006. It was blocked by stones. I mean, the doors were closed. Nobody entered this room the last 50 years. And luckily, in this room, all the decoration is still preserved, even including the historic windows, window shutters, everything, and even these quite dusty surface of the ceiling still shows the original intended color scheme. And here one particular design intention of these rooms is visible, because it's the play of the light on these tiny metal-leafed areas. So if you move inside a room like this, the light will subtly dancing on all these tiny metal pieces. Similar like maybe to Indian textiles, which have all these tiny mirror pieces inside. Just some details of the ceiling, which you would never be able to see because it's about 7 meters high. And the whole room again appears like that. Because from a little bit more far distance, the colors do not look that bright anymore, because they just hold each other in balance, like in oriental carpets. So they have to be bright. They have to be bright because you would not see any detail when it's just brown. I simply love these colors, so I hope you enjoy it with me. Some more details, just showing how precious the flowers are painted, and every tiny detail is just lovely. The same is for inscription panels in these rooms, because often today they appear with brown background today, but originally they were meant to be white, like paper, with gilded letters and blue flowers surrounding them. And it's very similar if you look at Arabic calligraphy on paper and books. And a particular rare feature in these rooms is this bright blue. I only found 3 interiors till now where you still can see it, because it's made with glass powder. And if this glass powder pigment is covered by resin, like varnish or oil, then it turns dark. And this is something which is never reversible, because the paint layer drinks the varnish and will just stay black all over the time. So maybe you can understand why I was so surprised seeing this room in this untouched condition. This is another example which has been restored. It's in the Azim Palace in Damascus. But here, the craftsman brought back the blue color by repainting it. Now I will take you to another house. It's also one of these rare original interiors. If you just follow me through the door and raise your head, you will see this ceiling. It's again a ceiling that covers a seating area and just has very bright colors. And the same again with this bright blue background of the center panel. And actually in the Western collections, a few pieces are preserved that still show the original colors. This is installed in NYU in New York. And this actually is a piece that belongs to the center of the small Syrian room here in Shangri-La. This is my discovery from this week. I had this assumption already from last year, because I know that these pieces, or I knew that these pieces altogether, were shipped from Damascus in the 1930s to New York. And then in the 70s, they were divided and came to three different locations, to Princeton, to Shangri-La, and some state in New York. But I will stay in my nice Beit Krasiha for the moment, because this is another example of the same room covering the entry space and really give an idea like a carpet. And we still stay with the same color style, which is always light blue and pink. And this is still a quite traditional design, I would say. And some years later, these European-influenced Baroque ceilings appear in Damascus. And I will take this ceiling as a starting point to introduce some other details. It is mirrors that came in fashion in Damascus starting in the second half of the 18th century and leading to such mirrored rooms. The first ceiling that is adorned with still tiny mirrors, it's in Bichirazi. It's one of the largest residences in Damascus. And here, cautiously, four tiny mirrors are placed in the ceiling center. And then in Beit Horanir, which is about 25 years later, the mirrors are getting bigger and a higher number is used, because mirrors were not available in Damascus. They were shipped from Italy and England, as far as I know, and were, of course, very much expensive. And then this fashion was developed to create such types of ceilings where mirrors are placed almost everywhere, ending up with the famous so-called grape room in Beit Nizam, where the highest amount of mirrors are detected. And interestingly, also older ceilings that had still a high value have been updated during this mirror fashion, and small mirrors were just placed on appropriate places to make it also such a mirror ceiling. In the parallel time, as these mirrors came up, also large mural paintings became in fashion. And this particular depicts Istanbul. And it even helps to date this interior and this painting, because it's only the first bridge covering the Bosporus. And the second one, which was built 1842, I think, is not depicted yet. So the scholars date this room even around 1840. And here we are again back in the grape room in Beit Nizam, that has been painted by artists from Istanbul, as we know from an English traveler who reports that. And you see even the grapes that give the name for that room. Then the fashion developed further, and this type of canvas ceilings were made since the 1830s and were extended to large sizes to the 1860s and 70s. And this is the largest saloon being equipped with such a canvas ceiling. And you see clearly the difference between the old tradition polychrome wooden ceilings and these, again, lighter and less heavier canvas ceilings. Now I will take you again to a conservation adventure, because many of the houses have been maintained many times because they are still in use. And every generation has another taste, so many rooms have been painted by modern fancy colors. But luckily, the people were often too lazy to sand it down before applying the paint. So we are able to remove the paint layers to show original surfaces. And I had the really great privilege to be involved in the restoration or conservation of the grape room in Beit Nizam. It's a project from the Aga Khan Trust for Culture, and we began to work in this famous grape room. And I expected already from tiny places that the original color of the room should be a light blue, instead this dark green. But it has been painted more than 100 years, because we know historic photographs from the 1880s still already showing this dark surface. But it was really an overwhelming discovery to not even find light blues, on instead pink lines and pink painted details, small landscapes in the ceiling cornices, and a lot of other tiny precious details. And I was a little bit scared as I start this work, because everybody in Syria knows this room. It's often used for public receptions of politicians and movie stars or something. So I was just a bit afraid that people would not believe the original surface. But it turned out so lovely that, the people were very much pleased to see how much higher the quality of the paintings even was. If you just look at the flower bouquet on the right side, with the green overpaint, you didn't even see the leaves, for example. And finding this, it's a tiny piece of a wall closet. I didn't expect it would turn out even with decoration. I thought it's simply light blue. And it was, of course, very fascinating for me as a conservator to revealing the original blue painted landscapes instead of yellowish, greenish overpaintings that covered completely the landscapes. This is an insight in the work, but you have to imagine the room a little bit more dark blue, because this is also a sign of light damage, because indigo has been used to paint all of that, and this is not really light stable, and in the very intense sun of Damascus, it faded already. But the intention of the landscapes is still there. And this is just a view to the ceiling of the grape room being almost cleaned. And one of the most fascinating discoveries was this little tiny landscape in the cornice, because here the little mountains even show up with tiny trees. Nobody would see them sitting down in the reception room. It's just the painter couldn't do something else. Yeah, this is just the big change of that famous room appearing like that. But it's not finished, because the carvings, the grapes are still missing. But unfortunately, we had to stop the work last summer. So my scaffolding is still waiting for me, hoping for a better future. Thank you very much.